Well, we welcome you to our fourth and final session. It's a little sad to be saying this is over. Mondays are just great to look forward to and to know we'll be sharing some books and strategies with you. And we do love to hear about what you've tried, what you've encountered, what has worked well, what has not worked. So does anyone have anything? Oh, look at this. Right. She was right. Fabulous.
The you read, I read. I think that is such a great idea for, especially when you're trying out a new book with your new reader, because sometimes going through it the first time is the most painful because they are encountering a lot of new words. So just by doing that gives them confidence right off the bat. And it also works good in tight situations that we all have where they're like, oh, I don't know if I can get the reading in tonight. And that way it's more doable if you're you know, up against the gun of getting things done.
Mm-hmm. Oh, great. And you know, the word confidence is, you're right on with that, right? It's all about bringing the joy and the confidence and that time with you, the parent, that it doesn't always have to be that you're, you know, just knowing and understanding that you're supporting your child's reading development, and it doesn't have to always be hard work. And just any opportunity to be reading with them is a wonderful one. So that, thank you. I'm glad to hear that one.
I wanted to say the book that I borrowed from you, I think it was last week, Shout the Poems. I can't remember, it's by Broad, B-R-O-D. Anyway, it was the poetry book with like the silly poems about like ketchup and all those things. I never think to read poetry at home because I'm always like, oh, we read our story, and that's like my preference. And so I kind of go toward that. We read it last night, and I was going to bring it back to you tonight, but she loved it so much. She was like, can we read one more? Can we just read one more? And I just, it was just, you know, I don't have a you know, life-altering experience, but she just loved it. And it reminded me that it's not necessarily just about what I'm used to, about my preferences, you know.
That's such a good point. I think of that point as a teacher as well, that I really preferred fiction. I really did not enjoy reading nonfiction, but understanding that for some kids, that's what it's all about, and really thinking about reaching beyond what is your preference. Thank you for that.
So I think that confidence piece, and also my daughter realizing the different tactics that we've been using along the way. She's now more confident reading signs and things outside of the home with me. So this is kind of funny. We were in the bathroom at the gymnastics class, and they had a sign about washing your hands before returning to class. But it was a full sentence. She definitely didn't know all the words, but she wanted to read it with me, and she tried skipping a word and coming back to it. So it was kind of amazing that, you know, even though in stories it's easier to get the context from pictures, this was just a black and white sheet of paper that she wanted to read with me. And so, and she's been reading a lot more signs and things around town. So it's interesting to see, like, she's finally
taking risks.
Yeah. Because otherwise she would never want to read in front of me in case she made a mistake. So
cereal boxes, any kind of, we call that environmental print. Any kind of environmental print is another good way. But the fact that she went about wanting to read that just reinforces that she's becoming awareness of concepts of print, that print carries a message, and when I see those letters and those words grouped together, there's a reason for that. It's just not randomly stuck behind the sink. That's fantastic. That's like a discovery that, oh, print happens all around us, not just in books, and it carries a message. It's a huge discovery.
And sometimes for reluctant readers, environmental print is a nice way to go because they're not intimidated by a book that's thick with lots of words. You know, you can read things in the grocery store and you can slip it in without them really realizing how they're practicing that. So it can work both ways to build up confidence and sort of get those reluctant readers hooked in.
Anybody new tonight? Have you listened at all? Have you looked at the age cam?
I've just
wondered if people have been accessing them. Mm-hmm. After tonight, we'll have the PowerPoint, the entire PowerPoint from all of our sessions up on both the Center School website as well as under the superintendent's link to the district page, so that people who want to go back, and then we'll have all the handouts listed there too. And so I'll find out. I'm not sure. Has anybody tried to see if they could access?
There's two that are up.
Great.
The second and the third are up, and the first one was yet to be up.
Through HCAM?
Yes.
Through there?
Okay. It's on the education, HCAM Ed.
Great. That's fantastic.
Special.
So thank you for that, HCAM.
So we're going to, any other stories? I mean, we can, oh, great.
Just one little, like, win. So my husband travels a lot, and he said to me the other night, he's like, there's like a step change in Lila's love for reading, which I was like totally, and he was like the, well, sound it out, and like not even thinking that you really can't sound out that word. And so, I don't know, I feel like I've improved my methods, and she's
nice.
Enjoying it, so that's good. So
and he noticed.
And he noticed, which
her attitude had changed. Or
yeah.
Not just him.
Yeah, no, she just likes, she wants to, like, before she was like, no, you read, and now she, like, wants to read to her brother, and
wow.
She's into it, so.
So now that you're up to over a dozen strategies, have any of you tried having your child choose? What strategies do you want to read with tonight?
Yeah, I don't have a choice. She picks.
She just, this
she
is what
picks.
Moves my mom.
Mommy, I feel like a nudge tonight.
Yeah.
All right, I feel like a little nudge.
Good. That's awesome. Yeah. But try that with your kids, because it really empowers them. To say, you know, let them pick a strategy, it can be random, or I know sometimes multiple strategies will work, but it really empowers them as readers to hold on to that book and to be the one that's in control of what strategies are being used.
We fall into multiple. I mean,
yes.
We might start off one way, but by the end of the book, I'm like, what haven't we done? I mean, there's maybe a couple that she's not as into. Like, Slide doesn't really, she doesn't need it as much.
Right, because she's, that's her fallback strategy.
She doesn't need that, but other ones, make her word, and I find that we both naturally sort of figure out which one works best on that word, and then we move on. No, so we keep going back to the original ones and the new ones. It's sort of always a mix.
Yeah,
and that's
nice.
Important because some strategies, as we've learned throughout the series, are not the best strategies in that particular case. So you do need to differentiate throughout a story. While you might start off saying we're going to nudge tonight, you might have something else that's more applicable to help decode that word.
So we're going to start tonight in your handout, and this is a handy thing to just keep by the bedside or wherever you're reading until they become natural to you, and that's more prompts. So there's a list of useful prompts, and I know 2 weeks ago we gave you some to try. They don't necessarily come naturally, and these are actually prompts from a teacher training that I've done, and we'll say to the teacher, keep it right there on the desk, because your go-to prompts are the ones that you just use naturally. So, you know, using this prompt, what would make sense when they stop? So that at that time, when they themselves stop, because they're stuck on the word, but you know that there's context that they can use. So you can either prompt them to go to the end of the sentence and then come back, or you can say, what would make sense? What makes sense? And maybe guide them to the beginning sounds. And again, you're reminding them that they're supposed to be, whatever the message is here is supposed to make sense. I love this one. So let them finish the sentence in this case. Wait till they go to the end of the sentence and then take them back to the word that they miscued, point to the word and say, you said whatever they said. Does that look and or sound right? So once again, you're empowering them. You're reminding them what you heard they said, or this is the one where you can also say, what didn't, or where was the tricky word? But I really like this one specifically, when you can hear the child's, their own word, and it's usually a word that makes sense. It's not a made up word in this case. You said,
but you said
puppy.
Pop, or, okay, puppy.
You said puppy, and the word is dog.
Mm-hmm.
You said puppy. Does that look, does it look right? Well, it doesn't look right because it's a short word and puppy's a long word, and they know that already. But it also doesn't sound right because the word that you're pointing to starts with a D. Use that sparingly for something like dog and puppy. We've talked about this before. When they substitute a word with the correct meaning, be careful about taking them back too often because it takes away the fun. But it, you know, you can use it occasionally. This is really useful when they substituted a word that doesn't make sense. And then you can take them back and say, you said this, you know.
And we had an example from one of the previous weeks about that where a child had something, and whether it was the irregular tense of a word or how, somehow it did, and it changed the meaning, it did not make sense. So sometimes when children will hear you repeat what you said, then they know that's not the order of words in a sentence, and that will help them problem solve.
And we've all discovered that they love it, right? When they figure it out for themselves and you don't tell them, they get really excited about that. Others on this page we've talked about, but the one at the bottom, you read that word on another page and then show it to them. So you've heard them read it correctly a couple of times. Often this happens when there's a capital. So it'll be the same word they've read a couple of times. Maybe they had context and they got the word. Then all of a sudden it looks different because it's at the beginning of a sentence and it's capitalized and they'll miscue it. You know that they can read that word. So take them back again and say you read this on another page and show them where they read it. Don't say it. Just say that here's the same word. They're going to get it. They're going to go back to that page and see it again and read it correctly this time, and once again, just feel really good about that. Is that making sense? Do you want to do the next step?
Sure. So when you're reading and you're uncomfortable word, it might be a multisyllabic word, it's got a lot of parts to it, or you know, say caterpillar. You know they know part of the word, but initially when they're looking at all those letters, it's just so overwhelming. Maybe even cover up some of the ending letters and say, you know, what's that little word that you see in the larger word, and help them break it apart. Because cat they might be familiar with, then even using some of the rest of the story, there might be a picture clue, and they'll get caterpillar. That would help with words that you can sound out that part in the word. Sometimes you'll have a component of a word. We have lollipop in a story, you could break out some at the beginning. Sometimes you'll have a word, of course right now it escapes me, you'll have a word part but it sounds differently when it's in a larger word. I wouldn't use it in that case. You want it to still sound like it looks like cat and caterpillar, pill and pillow, so that you can break apart that short, maybe it's just CBC or short vowel word, and then build on the ending for them. And then, would you like a clue? When you see your child reading, sort of pausing, you know something's going on, they're trying to figure out the word, they might have difficulty knowing which strategy to apply at that time. So instead of just telling them what the word is, would you like a clue? And sometimes children will readily say no. Sometimes they'll say yes. And then it might be, this word sounds like, I had an example in one of the books, if I can find out where. It might be a word that they're just not familiar with. It sounds like moaned, but it begins with a different sound, groaned. They might then rhyme the word. You know, when here was pill, you could cover up the end for pillow, help sound that out. Here's a word buried, that's tricky. So if you can give a word that it sounds like, and they can add that rhyming piece, they know the beginning sound, it would be difficult for them to use a picture clue for buried here. But if you can give them a language pattern to help them identify that word.
A meaning clue.
Meaning clue, exactly.
It could be another, it means the same as.
Mm-hmm. Another strategy to do is, you know, the strategy, the meaning, the rhyming words. So the key is asking, would you like some help, giving that wait time. We talked about this in our first session, just not jumping in right away to save the day. Let them problem solve, maybe have a little bit of trouble, because the first strategy they might apply, they might self-correct and realize something else makes sense. But offering that, would you like some help? Especially for those children that have tried some strategies and have had some success, to become better at something, you need to practice it. And if you swoop in too early, they're not going to get all of that practice.
And you know what the other thing when Lauren says that swoop in too early, the other message kids get when you swoop in, when you rescue them, the message they get from you is that you don't think that they can do it, right? So your confidence in them comes across when you provide that wait time. And kind of step back a little bit to let them try to figure it out and give them some clues. So our first strategy tonight is give me a clue.
Yep, so we just have a variety of stories here. So here is an example.
Okay. So are you going to be the student tonight?
Sure. Okay. Get my post-its here. There are nut shells on the counter, but a scorcher.
So, it doesn't really mean the same. So I'm going to give you, do you want a clue?
Yes. Yes, I do.
It's a little animal that runs around and he has a straight tail. Okay. And he likes seeds and nuts.
Oh, chipmunk.
Yeah,
chipmunk. Okay. Left them there. But there are nutshells on the counter, but a chipmunk left them there. He was making nut.
Do you want another clue?
Yes.
It rhymes with nudge.
Fudge. Sundays. See, then I got Sundays because it smelled differently than the day of the week that I'm used to seeing in school, but nut fudge Sundays and the picture helped with that. So sometimes there'll be a picture, a clue. So she didn't break apart the phonic aspect of chipmunk to me. She provided some background knowledge because I've seen them in my yard. But at first I wanted to say squirrel, but it didn't match up with the print and I knew that. So that helped me arrive at chipmunk.
And for fudge, I could have used a meaning clue. You know, it's a flavor that you like to eat or something like that. So rhyming, language, or just the background that we use there.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I didn't. I think the respectful piece of it comes through by asking if they want a clue. I probably could have waited a little bit longer before I jumped in to ask her if she wanted a clue. But kids like this one, and they even just like seeing the little detective on the star, you know, that give me a clue kind of detective. And I can think about print and ways of solving it.
Mm-hmm.
I can prove it is a little bit different than give me a clue. Mm-hmm. So I can prove it is a way of having your reader articulate to you that they know how they figured out the word. So you can use this when you've just seen them really successfully figure out a word. And then you can say to them, how did you figure that out? How can you prove that you were right? You can say, you're right, that's what that word is. I saw you back, or I saw you do this. But how did you prove that? Is reinforcing to them that you know that they're aware of the metacognitive piece that they're applying when they're using right reading strategies. And it's really important to reinforce because then they're more apt to apply them when they're reading on their own and you're not right there beside them. You're telling them they got it right and you're reinforcing that they know how they can do that again another time. Okay, so that sounds a little, did you have one?
Well, if, you know, talk on some of these. So we read some of the story, maybe we went back and forth, so now it's my turn to read a page. Duck pedaled a little faster. He rode past horse. Hello, horse, said duck. Nay, said horse. But what he thought was, you're still not as fast as me, duck. So say, I guess.
So you struggled a little bit with this word,
mm-hmm.
but you figured it out. How did you prove that word?
Because on the other pages they were pedaling bikes and I remembered some other animals pedaled and that's what Duck was doing here.
That's it. So you were remembering
mm-hmm.
that all of the other parts of the story would also, you needed to remember parts of that as you read the next page.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
That's excellent.
Mm-hmm. So even though it wasn't exactly on this page, it was prior in the story, so it's nice to bring that back. Because that would be a little difficult world, peddled,
mm-hmm.
when you look at that word. So even, and are you my mother? How did you know that? So here I might say, well, it's a pattern, it keeps happening. He's looking up, he's looking down, he didn't see her. Where you have that pattern, so the response might be, because it keeps happening. There's a pattern, the language, the words keep saying the same thing. But then what would be key is when the language pattern changes. So how did you know where that is? Of course, let me get to the part where it changes. It's in there. But that would be something to notice when the language pattern changes and the child changes with it. How did you know it wasn't the same pattern? Where on every other page it said, are you my mother? No, I'm not your mother. And then here, it changed to, oh, you are not my mother. You are a snort. I have to get out of here. You know, with the other ones, we didn't have that.
you can talk about the words, the exclamation points, the you know, everything that goes with it. So that's important to point out as well.
Good.
So I noticed that you brought a wordless picture book.
Well, those were these were Denise's. We have a lot of wordless picture books out tonight
great.
Too.
Which is great, because we're going to talk about some of the next one going to be to give me a clue. We're going to talk about Shadow Me and Look at the Mark. So we could talk about this one for the one that we're talking about now, which is Give Me a Clue. So the idea that you can use Give Me a Clue with a wordless picture book as well, very, very important strategies for reinforcing the use of pictures. And we talked before about Jan Brett and other authors where there's a second story happening in the background. So having your children use what they see from the illustrations and taking the opportunity to have a wordless picture book and use the word reading. Let's sit and read this book together is a very strong message for you to give your students that says it's not only okay, but the pictures and illustrations provide really important information. And the fact that they can sit and read this story with you, the vocabulary that comes in as they fashion the story that they're going to tell you based on the pictures that tell a story in this book with absolutely no words to accompany them. So it's a really, and it, you know, for young kids, it really reinforces even just how do you read a book? Will you read a book right left to right and top to bottom? So we would not read these pictures this way. We would need to read the pictures this way, sequentially. They just, it wouldn't make sense if we tried to read them that way. So there's all sorts of things that kids can learn. Kevin Hankes, if you're familiar with his illustrations, they're all over the place. Kevin Hankes is a great books to use to teach kids directionality as well. The vocabulary is a little bit higher, so it would be a good you read then I read book type of book to read. But the idea that it reinforces, no matter the fact that there's a little illustration here, and then sometimes the font goes all over the place in the book, but it's fun and it's entertaining, and there'll be some words and then a little illustration and then maybe some more over here, but it does follow the pattern. It never goes this way. It always goes left to right and top to bottom. So those are fun books to read with kids as well. And so the idea of giving me a clue is, you know, how did you know, or why do you think that is what's going to happen next? And your child can say, well, because this is what happened in that picture, and I can see what's going to happen next based on. So they're reinforcing their comprehension and proving it to you from either something they saw earlier, as you saw Lauren did. Well, I saw the peddling pictures. Clearly, what happens before in the story is going to be important for me to apply to my understanding as I move forward through the story. Did you have anything else on wordless picture books?
Well, just for children, that a lot of energy goes into reading. That might be a nice change, even for your readers, your developing readers, and you've got your imagination and just let your language flow. So there is an opportunity to practice language, word order, vocabulary, because you could even do a nudge with a picture book, and when you're describing a picture, maybe you would add some of those more robust vocabulary words, and it would be interesting to see if your child on a later page incorporate some of those vocabulary words in their telling of the story.
So this one is absolutely wonderful. It's called Mouse Around, and there are two stories taking place. There's a leak, and you can see that, so there's a leak, there's a little mouse that sees the drop of water, but the story that's happening is that clearly somebody has come in to fix the leak. There's another story happening with the little mouse. You can see the little tiny illustration in the bottom corner where the mouse is slipping into his pocket. But then where it gets exciting is that you can see him walking up the stairs to the kitchen with the mouse in his back pocket. So all sorts of language about, uh-oh, what's about to happen? And then he comes into the kitchen. You can see that mom and dad are having a bit of an argument. She's got her hands on her hips. And the kids are at the kitchen table having a snack. And you see the little mouse running for the box of donuts. So there's all sorts of anticipation about what's about to happen next. And lots of excitement. from a story that just has no words. What's really fun with this kind of a book is to stop and have your child write, or even tell you, dictate what's going to happen in the story, and then look and see if their predictions come through. And whether they come through or not, they could write their own story from that beginning idea.
Yeah. Create a new ending. Yeah. Change what do you think could happen, and sort of rewrite the story with an illustration even.
Yeah. We don't often think about wordless picture books, but they're really great, and clearly the library has a great selection of them. So mm-hmm. So we have Shadow Me, a little bit different. We kind of gave you a preview of it last week by mistake when we were reading together. And so Shadow Me is a little similar to you read and then I read, and it's similar to, we talked about choral reading, but it's also different. And so did you have something for Shadow Me? Sure. So I'm shadowing you.
Okay.
So I'm the shadow, I'm the parent. I'm going to be just physically and verbally just behind her voice. So I'm shadowing her reading. When she gets stuck, my voice is gonna get a little bit louder. As she gains confidence, my voice is gonna back off again. Okay? This is a fluency strategy.
Thump. Crash, thump, baby Tepper blunders into the green umbrella.
Blat, blat.
He falls. Mama. No. Okay, here's the Spanish part. But did you notice when I hesitated, I could hear the word in my ear, so then I could pick up and then join in? Exactly. Here we go. We'll try another one. Too hard. Just then, a little boy came out. What's going on? He asked. Well, the animals told him it's about the new one I heard, said the bird.
So that's the idea. The idea is that you're reading together, but you're letting your child take the lead. You're the guide by the side. It's very reassuring. It's really fun for them, but you're also, it really builds confidence, because the more they get into the story and they have some meaning there, the more they read confidently ahead. And that child who's resisting reading with you, so if you try this strategy, suddenly, oh, this isn't so bad, and reading's actually kind of fun, and I'm enjoying this time with my mom or my dad. And it really promotes. It's a good one to read. It's a good one to do as a new read. And then maybe you read that book again another night and they read it more independently. Great way to introduce a book that's slightly above their reading level.
And you know, that's important to reread the books that you've read together, because that builds fluency. So the first time you might have approached a story together, your child might have needed a lot of support. Another time, maybe you could do nudge, maybe you could shadow me, because the more they read it, the more fluent their reading will become. So it's like when you're talking. At the beginning, often readers are very choppy, word by word. Our goal is to build the reading fluency so that it sounds like when you're speaking. So another strategy we'll talk about is the attention to punctuation and how you change your voice, because that's always fun.
And you know, if it's a short enough book, just even the first read could be just you reading it to your child. Then they get to just listen in, understand what the story's about, have the meaning of the story where they're not having to figure out what the words are, but they know what this story's about. That's the first time through. Second time through, you could try something like what we just demonstrated. And then the third time through, they're independent. And they're going to be going and looking for this book independently to read. Again, something just a little bit higher than their reading level. So five-finger rule would be just about perfect. Books that they're making just about 5% errors on.
So when you're looking at punctuation, and this was the...
we're going to move on.
She's a taskmaster. You know, look at the marks. So you will have punctuation, you'll have exclamation points, question marks. Question marks, something I always use with students, you're hanging your voice on the hook. Your voice, when you ask a question, your inflection rises. So here's a book to practice. That's another great book to practice there, too. Yes, a lion has a mother, just like me and you. Does a giraffe have a mother too? When you look at a book like this, you've got, you know, large letters that are colorful. So what should I do with my voice? I should make my voice a little louder when I get there. And there's an exclamation point after yes. When I'm reading this, the print looks a little different, the font. So I tried to change my voice a bit and then raise my voice when I had that question to hang it on the hook, so to speak. So something like this where there's a lot going on, you could model how to inflect your voice and then have it be, okay, now it's your turn to try. Children love to change their voice, and you've probably encountered this at home when you're reading and you have different character voices or when something's going on. So you, many of you may know this book, Big Green Monster here.
So I just was gonna add to that, that what the way I always would refer to looking at the marks is, you know, reading the punctuation. So having kids understand that that little mark has meaning. It's there for a purpose. So in this case, Big Green Monster has two big yellow eyes. Now, that could be a sentence, right? It's a proper sentence, but there's no period there. So that tells us that there's more to come. We're going to turn the page and there's more to come. And again, I would just read this for fun right through first. I wouldn't do this the first time through. Just read the whole thing and then come back and say, hey, there's some things I'm noticing about this book that are important. That means that we're going to just take a breath or take a break, or the thought is not finished yet. A long bluish green nose with a comma. A big red mouth with sharp white teeth. Notice what my voice is doing. You know that there's more coming. Two little squiggly ears. Scraggly purple hair. So this is actually a great one with all the commas. And a big, scary, green face. Talking about the exclamation mark. But, dot, dot, dot. So you can talk about what does that mean, right? But, and teaching them to let their voice indicate that there's more to come. Huge font. You don't scare me, exclamation mark. So go away, scraggly purple hair. Again, bringing meaning into something as simple as the fact that there were commas at the end of the page, because otherwise, kids are just going to read, Big Green Monster has two big yellow eyes, a long bluish green nose, right? A big red mouth with sharp white teeth. So they're not getting nearly as much the richness that this book really has to offer by using the punctuation.
And here's another example. I loathe you. So here's a great page for the illustrations here. I loathe you more than slimy rats, more than frostbite, skunks, or bats, more than fuzzy mold on cheese, more than fever or disease. Picture lobsters pinching me. I loathe you more. Now do you see? So like even a page like that, we had commas, we had exclamation point, we had the dots, the hesitation, and sometimes it's even, what did you notice about what I was reading? And at first, then, you know, a child might not notice anything, so say, well, listen to this one. I loathe you more than slimy bats, more than frostbite, skunks, or bats. And see if they notice, well, that was too fast, because we talked before, being a fluent reader doesn't mean you're a fast reader. You know, there's so much meaning that you can put in with your voice and when you pause. So sometimes it might be nice to read it and say, what did you notice about that time? You know, geez, Mom, you didn't take a breath. You just went right through, and it wasn't as enjoyable. But there are some great things to point out. And when you start pointing these out when children are reading books, many times you'll see it carry over to their writing. They'll try to experiment with where to put commas, where to put those dot, dot, dots for that extenuating pause. So it's great to see, because then they're transferring some of their skills.
And of course the opportunity for vocabulary there is all over it, right?
Moldy, yeah. Cheat, I mean.
What do we think loathe means?
Oh, I know. Oh, look at this print. This will be a fun page to read. Suppose somebody, I lose my stink. What would you say? What'd you think? I think someone doesn't want to take a bath in this story. So I think someone loathes the bathtub. But that's a great vocabulary word, too, to loathe.
Fabulous. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, questions about anything? All right.
You can borrow that one, too.
In your handout tonight, we also have some strategies for proficient fluent readers. Because all of your children are going to be wanting you to challenge them because they're going to be such good readers, and already many of them already are great readers. We talked about this at the beginning, but this wasn't only for kids who struggle, to give you strategies for developing readers as well as confident readers. So there are, I don't know what my time is.
2 minutes.
Okay, so there's some strategies here we'll talk a little bit about, and then at the last part of your handout is just from some really useful websites for parents, for ideas, resources, articles, fun activities for kids, is also in your handout. So we'll just spend a little bit of time talking about proficient readers. The first, and we've touched on some of these, but just really encouraging different genres for children to explore. Get them beyond their safety net of the same types of books. You talked about the poetry, and that being something that, you know, hadn't been something that you typically would have done, how much your child enjoyed it. So really encouraging kids to try out different genres, certainly to read in different genres again, a topic that they're really interested in. So that's a great way to get somebody hooked if it's something that they really enjoy. You can read about it by researching it. You can read about it in a nonfiction book. You can, all different ways. The newspaper, looking up articles in the newspaper about whatever that topic is that your child enjoys. So having them, try out a historical fiction as something that would be different, maybe something they haven't done before.
And for some of those readers that might shy away from books, so to speak, there are so many children's magazines now, Sports Illustrated for kids, National Geographic for kids. I think probably every type of magazine has a children's version. That's a way you can target their interest level. And obviously, if children are interested, they're more motivated to read, to find out about, you know, the sports star that they emulate and want to be like when they're in the NBA some year. So that's just a wonderful example. And then talking about the features of text we talk about, the features of a magazine, the idea that the caption has really important information. It's trying to draw you to a summary of what you're going to read, and using the terminology,
the
caption,
text features,
and illustration.
They are, absolutely. The fact that, you know, there are headlines here that are giving me a synopsis. And one of the things that we teach kids specifically is when they're reading about an illustration, and sometimes there's a caption, and the caption is not necessarily in the text. And if you don't read the caption, you're going to miss important information. So direct teaching or discussion or opportunities about features of text that are not typically in a fiction. Are things they are learning but in school, but they really enjoy too. And the fact that you don't have to read the whole article. You could just read part of the article, you know, look at the headings and let's read a piece of this that really interests you. And how can we using the index so that they have a table of contents. And understanding that means that you go to that page to begin that article, and let's just skim this table of contents and see what article. We all do it, right, when we're reading a magazine, but kids don't know to do that. So having those opportunities as well. Mm-hmm. So do you want to pick up here?
Sure.
There you go.
So things when you're reading, whether it's a magazine, a story, whether you're reading or your child, point out those key vocabulary words that just sound interesting. Just the way you say that. Wow, load. Or in Big Green Monster, the squiggly eyes. Some words just sound great. They sound neat. But talk about those words, and even when you have some key vocabulary words from a story, you know, what does it mean? What's another way to say that? Use some of those vocabulary words in everyday life when there's an opportunity. Just like your child when they were learning foods and they needed, you know, 14 opportunities to like something that was new. For vocabulary words, you really need to use it multiple times to be able to own it and have it be part of your own vocabulary. So just hearing it once is in a story, that's wonderful, that's great. But for words that children might not be familiar with, they're going to need that multiple exposure and practice using that word in context. So that would be your modeling to them. So when you're reading, picking apart those words, when you're having a conversation with your child, using adult vocabulary so they can, you know, a conversation, let's just talk, let's have a conversation. It's amazing when you see children who are familiar with an exchange back and forth with that rich vocabulary, they're then able to carry on a multiple exchange conversation and incorporate some of those vocabulary words. And it's amazing when you hear a little one and they throw words out like suggestions and strategies, and they're doing it independently without prompting, and it's because it has become part of their everyday life with that rich vocabulary. Examples when you especially have nonfiction text and you're looking at information and you're learning about the constellations and the names of them and all those scientific terms, you know, try to incorporate that in other places outside of that shared reading experience, and then it just helps solidify, you know, the world around you and where that vocabulary connection is.
Reading the book version of a favorite movie is another great thing to do, and then talking about the differences between the movie and the book. They've got the background knowledge now. They know the sense of what the story is. Polar Express, right? That's a really good example. It's so different than the book. And you can talk about the differences, the things that you were expecting to happen, the things you weren't expecting to happen. Kids can really enjoy doing that. The other thing is talking about multiple perspectives. So,
great story.
Go ahead.
You know, you've got the three little pigs and then the true story of the three little pigs. So the traditional story we know, the three little pigs, you know, that big bad wolf, he's just awful, those poor pigs. You may be familiar with the story, the true story of the three little pigs by John Sisko, I believe it is. And it's the wolf telling his story. He was framed, it was wrong, he just had a cold. He was trying to find something to help soothe him. And it's not his fault they built their house out of straw and it blew down when he coughed. But it's an interesting perspective because you're not usually taking the view of the wolf, because in your mind he was big and he was bad. So it adds a completely different side of the story. So there's a series of those. There's the true story of the three little pigs, something about the frog.
I was just going to say, in general, fairy tales are, I'm sorry,
Fairy
tales are really easy to do multiple perspectives.
Right.
There's so many.
Mm-hmm.
And there's also many just multiple perspectives, but so many cute, like, there's like the three little fish and the big bad shark.
Right.
There's one that's the three bad, like the three naughty pigs and the good wolf, or, you know, there's so many different versions. Yeah.
And something at the younger level, children are still in that egocentric phase where the world revolves around them. I'm sure you know this. So it's very hard for them to take the perspective of another. So sometimes bringing that to life through stories help children see that there's another way to take in or view that situation. So that's just another wonderful teaching strategy as well. But that's do you have an example?
I know.
Or are you stretching? I don't know. It's like you're in class.
I like the is it Dear Goldilocks, which is it's like it's got the three little pigs. It's got Goldilocks in it, and I think it has like Peter Rabbit in it, and they're all writing letters back and forth to each other. But it also brings in perspective because I like that it's letter writing. Kids don't get to
the Jolly Postman.
That's
another
the Jolly Postman, yeah.
There's another, the Goldilocks Returns, which is she comes back years later. And it's another one about the princess and the pea from the point of view of the pea.
Right, nice. So and that's just a nice connection. Children are usually familiar with the fairy tale, so they have a nice starting point, especially at the younger age, to have a reference point and then try to change or just expand your view of thinking.
There's one that I used to love to read to first graders, and it's called Somebody in the Three Blairs. And somebody is the bear, and the Blairs is the Blair family. And kids think it's
hilarious. It's one for them to easily get perspective, because they know exactly what's going to happen and they can predict it, but instead somebody is this bear, and the little bear person gets in all sorts of trouble, so they just think it's hilarious. So that's another cute one. We talked about writing letters, so encouraging your child to write a letter to the author. Sometimes the author will actually has a website and will actually have somebody actually answering those letters. So particularly if it's a favorite author, that can be really exciting and very encouraging for kids with their reading.
And even just to do a little research on their favorite author, someone here had a Lunch Lady story last week. And that author, Jarrett Krasachka, when you hear him speak, I've seen him speak a few times, he had at least 30 attempts to try to publish his writing, and they were all no thank you, no thank you. So he didn't know if he should just take the line of becoming an illustrator. But he persevered, nice lesson to teach children, kept plugging away at it, and to see how his career, it didn't just happen overnight. And on his website, I even think he has examples of his writer's workshop from when he was in school, and it looks very similar to what children are writing, the stories, and it just gives them a connection that looks like what I do in school. So maybe this could be my future writing stories. It's just wonderful for children to learn a little bit about their author. So here they are, they might be reading along the way, some nonfiction, but just helping add a little bit more information and connection for them.
So I'm going to start or finish with what we started with, which is to remind you that you are the most important. Reading with your child is the most important thing you can do. And to continue reading with your kids right through middle school, right as long as they'll let you. And the more you establish that habit with them now, the more likely they will be to continue to let you read to them. We have teachers in middle school reading children's illustrated books to kids, you know, high level illustrated children's books, so that kids know that that's still okay picture book is the word I should have used. Using a picture book is still okay. There's no, you know, rules that say that you have to stop using it after second grade. So just to thank you for attending this, to applaud you for attending and for looking for ways to support your kids, because it's so important. I mean, the last bullet says the amount of reading students do outside of school has a direct positive effect on reading achievement. And that's true, but kids who read outside of school because it's enjoyable. And what you're doing is helping your kids to feel that this is enjoyable, that it's not, you know, it's not painful. You used the word tonight when you said, I think you didn't say painful, but you said, you know, before you were talking about that strategy, and maybe you did say taking the pain away from it, because you can make it be an enjoyable time. So that kids, and this is where I get frustrated, that kids have to struggle. And I should make a plug for full day kindergarten right now. Because we really need to make sure that kids identify as successful learners from those very beginning years. Because that's how they label themselves, right from their first experiences in school. So the more time we have for them to learn and be successful and come away feeling confident, there's no greater gift than we can give them. Because once they've decided that learning is hard and that reading is hard, it's really hard to convince them. It's very difficult to convince them otherwise. Those first experiences that they have at home and the first experiences that they have at school are what's going to keep them for the rest of their lives. So.
And to transition to summer, Denise, yes, will talk Denise. About how to keep your children reading over the summer.
First of all, I'd like to thank both Laura and Kathy for doing this. It's been excellent. I basically want to say you have all these strategies now. I'm here to support you. And one of the things that we do here every year is we do a big summer reading program, because I get to see more kids than I see all during the year. It's a crazy time. It's our busiest time of year. It's fun. It's my most enjoyable time of year with the kids. I go home every night tired, which is a good thing. But
we try to make summer reading something fun for the children. They sign up, they earn dollars for reading hours, and they can buy things in the store and whatever. But the whole reason we do this is to support the literacy. I have a really great quote here. It's from Bernard Margolis, who's the New York State librarian. He said, "Public libraries, through their summer reading programs, put books into the hands of children," which is what we want to do. "This is the best antidote for summer slide in children's reading achievement. Access to books and library programs over the summer results in more reading, which in turn results in improved reading skills." And as I said, we are here all summer for you. We are just absolutely delighted to support you in any way we can. And I hope to see lots of you and your children here this summer.
So when, I know there's an, you can register for the program?
We usually start the sign up mid-June, or just as school is getting out. And we give the children several weeks to build up a little bit of cash in there. We pay them $1 for every hour that they read.
Nice.
In library bucks.
Nice.
And then the store will open in mid-July and they can come in. But it's been great. And we had last year, I figured out that of the 602 children who signed up, which was our highest yet, almost 67% kept coming back and participating in the program, which I was just thrilled. And I'd like to make it even higher this year.
So do you ever have guest readers?
I would be delighted to have a guest reader.
Sure.
We would love to do that.
Yes, let me know your schedule and we will work something out.
All right.
That would be wonderful.
And I know Erin, drum roll.
Drum roll.
Oh, our raffle for all of those attendees. Thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, yeah. Make sure you put your tickets in.
Drag my tickets.
So Erin's going to do the winner.
What's left?
We want to know what the prize is.
Books.
Patent bookseller donated some books.
Yeah.
To the library.
Some books. And Patent. And,
I know, it's sometimes.
Oh, wow.
You're done.
That's great. You got the fly swatters.
You can bring that.
That's nice.
Yeah. Dawn, pinch place.
Oh yes.
And Denise has helped us with this. In the summer, for long trips, they have books on tape. It's wonderful for the kids. And the library has such a nice selection. The kids really get so interested in listening to the stories.
That's a great point. With my son, we did that with Tom Sawyer. He was so interested in the story, the book level he would not have been able to read. But to hear that story and the voices just while you're driving the car, it was great.
Yeah.
And there's some great stories that you'll enjoy listening to as well as your children.
It's a great way to keep them quiet, too.
Well, once again, thank you, HCAM. Thank you so much for being here for the past 4 Mondays. We really appreciate it. And that's it. We're signing off.